Heart Drum and Harper Audio present Sisters of the Neversea by Cynthia Leitich Smith, performed by Katie Anvil Rich. Chapter 1. Tick, tock, tick, tock. Each tick, tick, ticking second brought Lily and Wendy closer to the end of their time sharing a home as stepsisters. Not that they were on speaking terms anyway. You see, Wendy's father, Mr. George Darling, that's him in the trim navy suit, he had already accepted the assignment on Wall Street. And Lily's mama, Miss Florine Roberts Darling, that's her in the bright blue calico, she had flat out refused to quit her job with the tribe and move away from Oklahoma. And this, in turn, had created a rift between the girls over their own summer living arrangements. But that evening, the whole family was still together, surrounded by community, celebrating Big Brother John's high school graduation. Gripping her rolled-up ceremony program, Lily exclaimed, "He's next! John's next!" Flashing a brilliant smile, John strode across the stage in a flowing black robe with a beaded eagle feather dangling from his mortarboard. His parents and siblings proudly rose, cheering. His grandparents, aunties, uncles, and cousins proudly rose, cheering. Great Auntie Lillian had done the beadwork herself.
"He looks so grown up," Wendy exclaimed as John raised his diploma high.
"Way to go, John!" Lily sang out, as if he could hear her from the arena bleachers. In that joyful moment, Wendy Moira Angela Darling never would have muttered that John was merely her stepbrother, and Lily Maria Roberts never would have boasted that John was her real brother. Instead, Wendy blinked back tears because everything was changing, while Lily gave her mama and daddy bouncing high fives. Meanwhile, Mr. Darling lifted the siblings' four-year-old baby brother, Michael, onto his shoulders for a better view of John's big moment.
"John! John! John! John!"
Michael chanted, clapping. "John! John! John! John!" Michael shared a mama, Miss Roberts Darling, with Lily and John. Michael shared a father, Mr. Darling, with Wendy. Michael would be staying with Lily, John, and their mama in Tulsa, rather than boarding tomorrow's red-eye flight with Wendy and their father for New York City. Or so they all assumed at the time. The stepsisters' silent truce had lasted all the way through the very, 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 very long speeches and graduates' roll call and ceremonial fanciness. It had survived a few scathing looks and a couple of turned-up noses in the expansive leather backseat of Mr. Darling's sedan. What's more, the girls had managed to mostly avoid each other at the boisterous potluck reception in their backyard. On the wraparound wooden deck, Lily and Wendy helped serve sherbet fruit punch and chocolate raspberry sheet cake without exchanging a word.
"You girls must be so proud of John," Auntie Lillian said, accepting a plated serving.
"I'm proud that he graduated with academic honors," Lily answered.
"I'm proud that he got a baseball scholarship," Wendy replied, which was silly because they were both equally delighted with John all around.
Wiping chocolate icing from Michael's chin, Auntie Lillian remembered a time not long ago when the girls were inseparable and every third word out of their mouths was "we." High in the night sky, a cluster of curious, twinkling stars gathered to observe the festivities. As the crowd of partygoers thinned, the stars watched John exchange a round of hugs and handshakes. They watched Mr. Roberts, who was John's tall, jovial daddy, and, to be perfectly clear, also Lily's daddy, swing an arm around his son's shoulders and walk him to his pickup truck. They watched John hop behind the wheel, wave goodbye, and drive off to meet up with his school pals. Then the stars turned their attention to the younger children of the family, the ones who hadn't grown up yet. The stars knew what was coming. Who was lurking? They always did. They'd seen it all before, countless times, across vast green oceans and ethereal night skies. They recognized the tiny sparkling glow, nearly hidden in the wise old oak tree, sprawling above the Roberts Darling's backyard. They recognized the crouched, shadowy figures within its branches. The stars weren't the only spectators closely observing Lily, Wendy, and Michael. Chapter 2. The family cat, Spot, was, as her name suggested, a tawny spotted tabby with a rhinestone collar,
known for her perpetually alarmed expression and a tendency toward thievery. She dozed with one eye open on the padded window bench in the stepsister's shared bedroom. A navy blue dress sock, swiped from Mr. Darling, was hidden beneath her furry belly. Lily? Wendy slipped a fantasy novel into her overstuffed clear backpack, zipped it up, and propped it against the doorframe. Wendy aspired to be a wizard.
Yeah?
Lily was stretched out, flat on her back, on one of the two matching twin-sized canopy beds with puffy sky blue comforters. She didn't so much as glance over from her nonfiction book about large sea reptiles. Lily aspired to be a zoologist.
Never mind,
Wendy said, reaching for her last travel bag. Both girls were wearing lightweight cotton nightshirts with matching ankle-length bottoms. Lily's in a heart print and Wendy's in a star print, and house slippers with rubbery soles that offered a little grip on the hardwood floors. Auntie Lillian had given the girls the pajamas last Christmas. Wendy rolled socks and folded undies to tuck inside her bag. Lily turned page after page of a book that she was mostly pretending to read. Both stepsisters were quietly reflecting on family and loss. Wendy's earliest memories arose from her mother's funeral back in London. Wendy had been only 4, the age Michael was now. She didn't remember much. A gray day, a gray dress, her father's gray expression. As much as she loved Miss Roberts Darling, Wendy had said no thank you to her stepmother's offer of adoption, which had been extended almost a year ago on Wendy's 12th birthday. The idea of saying yes had felt somehow disloyal to the long-departed mother she knew largely through stories, old photos, and video. Lily's clearest memories from her preschool years were of Skittles, the classroom hamster, and her mama and daddy's divorce. At first, it had felt confusing, overwhelming, but both had stressed that they'd always be her parents. That would never change. This current family crisis was far more fraught with uncertainty. Only last year, Wendy had said no to being Lily's legally adoptive sister. If Wendy had said yes, then they would officially be sisters forever, and that would never change. But she hadn't. At first, Lily tried to understand Wendy's tender feelings. It must have been horrible to lose a parent, even if you could only faintly remember her. Perhaps that inability to remember made the loss even worse. But now the marriage that had made them stepsisters was in jeopardy. For the past several months, Lily had rationalized away the warning signs, refusing to believe the split would really happen. But suddenly, here they were. What if this summer's trial separation became a permanent one? What if Lily's mama and Wendy's father split up for good? The girls would be ex-stepsisters. What would that mean? Wendy was already moving away, starting a new life without Lily. There was nothing Lily could do about that. But Wendy could. Wendy could still say yes to officially being Miss Roberts Darling's daughter and, therefore, Lily and John's legal sister. So why didn't she? Didn't Wendy love them all enough? Alas, Wendy, having agonized to make her initial decision, the hardest thing she'd ever done, had closed her mind to the possibility and put it behind her. So Lily did her very best to swallow what felt like rejection. She did her very best not to dwell on it. Lily always did her very best, but sometimes a wisp of frustration slipped out. That night, both girls were trying and failing not to focus on their immediate futures, about the fact that, come morning, Wendy and Mr. Darling would leave for New York City. New York City was more than 1,300 miles away.
Mea culpa! Mea culpa!
Mr. Darling's voice boomed from the far end of the long hall.
Really, love, do we have to bicker on the night before I leave?
Straining to eavesdrop, neither girl could quite make out Miss Roberts Darling's reply. Then Mr. Darling said,
I can't seem to blast this tie!
It's a clip-on, remember? And pipe down, the kids will hear you.
How sad it was that their marriage had tumbled into disarray. They'd originally met as students at business school in Chicago. Miss Roberts Darling had enrolled with the goal of returning home to work in economic development for a tribal government. Mr. Darling had enrolled with the goal of clocking a few years on Wall Street before returning to England. Eventually, they had agreed to set up a household in Tulsa, which was a big city by Oklahoma standards. Miss Roberts Darling commuted to her job at the Muscogee Creek tribal headquarters in Okmulgee. Mr. Darling was a rising star at the U.S. Southwest Regional Office of an international financial firm. Or at least he used to be. Within hours, he would be off to the New York office with Wendy in tow.
It's the opportunity of a lifetime.
Besides, there's talk of closing the Tulsa branch, and then what would we do? We get by? What with John leaving for college, we don't need such a big house.
With John leaving, Mr. Darling countered. In case you have forgotten, university in the States is terribly expensive.
Florine, we're still paying off our own degrees. Not everything is about money, George, and it's not like living in New York is cheap.
That was enough bickering for the girls, who'd overheard it all before. Wendy zipped her last travel bag and shut the door. Lily sat up on her bed, hugging her knees.
In their distress, neither stepsister noticed the three colorful leaves on the hardwood floor. Neither sensed the danger lurking outside the open window.
I changed continents for you, Wendy pointed out, crossing the room to scratch Spot beneath her furry chin.
Wendy was seriously tempted to take the cat with her.
Why can't you spend this summer in New York with me?
It was to Lily's credit that she resisted the urge to point out that Wendy and Mr. Darling had relocated to the U.S. before their parents had met in Chicago.
I'm happy right here, Lily rocked slightly in place. This is home, our friends, our cousins. We're all supposed to go fishing on Lake Tenkiller next weekend. You could stay here in Tulsa this summer instead.
It was to Wendy's credit that she resisted the urge to point out that all of their cousins in Tulsa were on Lily's side of the family. All the cousins on Wendy's side of the family lived far away in England.
But think of it, Lily. New York City! Broadway! The Statue of Liberty!
Wendy seized on Lily's interest in biology. The Natural History Museum. Lily had a distinct fondness for dinosaur exhibits. Mixed feelings about native-themed exhibits, depending on their quality, and she felt vaguely unsettled by animal taxidermy. What she said was,
I'm not always a fan of natural history museums.
Lily, please. You could at least come and stay for my birthday.
It was only a couple of days away, and it was a sore subject. Mr. Darling's employer had been sympathetic to his waiting to begin the new job until after John's high school graduation. That was a once-in-a-lifetime event. But apparently, birthdays, which come around every year, didn't rate the same consideration. Even if it was the birthday that officially made you a teenager. Even if it was the birthday that meant you were really growing up. The stars peered at the girls through the bay window. They were better translators than the stepsisters. The stars understood that what Wendy was really saying was that she didn't want to leave Lily behind. And she was nervous about the summer, the possibility of starting her whole life over in New York. The stars also understood that what Lily wasn't saying was how much she'd miss Wendy, and how home wouldn't feel like home without her. What's more, Lily was terrified of flying on airplanes. Every winter, right after Christmas, Lily had been invited to come along to London to visit Wendy's side of the family, and every winter, Lily had declined and stayed in Tulsa with Auntie Lillian instead.
Dad bought you and Mikey plane tickets to New York, Wendy reminded her stepsister. They're paid for. You know Dad doesn't simply toss money around like that. You want them to go to waste?
Wendy was echoing what her father had exclaimed about purchasing the tickets.
I don't simply toss money around like that.
That's not my fault, Lily said. I've made it clear from the beginning that I won't go.
It went unsaid that if Lily turned down the trip, then Michael was out too. He was too little to fly back home by himself, and John couldn't come because of his summer job at the nearby steakhouse.
I know what you're thinking.
Yes, it's true that another cat might have noticed the intruders lurking outside, but Spot was self-occupied. Vexed that Wendy had stopped paying attention to her, the tabby stood, stretched, leapt off the window bench, and scampered out of the room to go sleep with Michael instead. She took Mr. Darling's navy dress sock with her.
How about 2 weeks? Wendy implored, never quick to give up. What if you came along to New York for the first couple of weeks?
She crossed the star-shaped throw rug.
It'd be an adventure. You could hurry and pack right now. I'll help.
Your adventure, not mine. Lily slipped under the covers.
You could celebrate your birthday here just as easily.
She clicked off the lamp on her nightstand.
If you want to leave home, fine, but don't expect me to make it any easier for you.
Wendy threw up her hands.
Why do you have to be so boring all the time?
Lily made a show of turning her back on Wendy.
Why do you have to be so flighty?
The girls quieted a moment, struggling to compose themselves. Their parents were still at it. Even with the door closed, the stepsisters could hear the muffled adult voices.
They'll wake Mikey, Lily said, sitting up again. if he's not up already. Wendy replied, don't strain yourself, I'll check on him. Fine, you do that. With a sigh, Lily got up from her bed, followed Wendy out of the room, and stomped off down the hallway in the opposite direction. Auntie Lillian, I didn't know you were still here, Lily said, entering the country kitchen. I thought you caught a ride with the Half Moons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.